However, that time it was. You see, the book of the law agitated by learning that fornication, drunkenness, and the abuse of drugs are all sins, which brought about this declaration. What a bummer. My horoscope said I was going to get a lot of bad news today. I never knew these things were sins, but now you tell me they are, I guess I'm responsible. I gotta go. And out he went. If he had stayed, I would have tried to enable him to discover that this wasn't really bad news, but truly good news. Not a few people in the church over the past 50 years have questioned the relevance of the Ten Commandments. You know, they're so negative, so restrictive of freedom, so tending toward the subservient. But the real thinkers and scholars have always tried to view the commandments as the ancient Hebrews were taught to do, and that is, in a positive light. What accounts for the difference in attitude between the Hebrews of old and so many of us? The Hebrews were absolutely convinced that Almighty God cared for them. They recalled his creative activity at the dawn of time, his liberation of them from bondage in Egypt, and his formation of them as holy people. They realized, in ways we frequently forget, that they were a chosen people who had a unique relationship with the Lord. Because of their covenant, they had been called to give visible public witness to their election for all the nations to see. In return for the special love they had received, the Hebrews were to observe the Lord's commandments. In the better times in their history, they didn't fall because they trusted in God's ongoing love and mercy, mercy for which they had already witnessed more than ample evidence. In reality, they were being asked to do very little, to trust the loving Father and to believe that he had a better idea regarding what could and should bring the greatest measure of happiness to both the individual and the community. In our romantic idealism and liberalism, we moderns have often thought that law is a stumbling block to human growth and development. But that need not be so, and usually is not so. Rules and regulations, intelligent ones that is, can often provide for the best conditions under which individuals can truly blossom as persons. Law can be a very liberating kind of thing, because it protects me from oppression by others and from oppression by some of my own baser instincts, which I might sooner deny. A rabbi recounted the story of how annoying and inhibiting traffic lights once seemed to him. He was sure that the 20-minute trip from his home to his synagogue could be cut in half without the traffic lights. Be careful what you pray for. Sometimes God gives it to you. One day there was a power outage and there were no lights. The 20-minute trip took 2 hours because of the massive confusion that resulted. He discovered a hard way that the short-term annoyance brought him to his destination more quickly and more safely. That's precisely how we should view the Ten Commandments as vehicles which inform us of God's will and facilitate our arrival home by the safest, surest, and swiftest way possible. Undoubtedly, these were the thoughts of the mind of the psalmist as he sang, "The law of the Lord is perfect, refreshing the soul." Love, conscience, commandments, freedom, peace. These words form a coherent whole. They are ultimately the most pleasing and grossly displeasing to modern man. But words which hang together perfectly in the minds of true sons and daughters of the covenant. So let's subject them to some detailed analysis. Conscience has become a favorite buzzword of some Catholics, including a cardinal who some time ago presented a very distorted view of the reality basic law of love, which underlies all commandments, as Christ points out today. My obedience to the commandments is a good barometer to determine just how loving a person I am. If we were to summarize God's attitude on Mount Sinai, it might be something like this. You say you love me? Clock is cheap. Show me. Cardinal Newman put it succinctly, holiness is love of the divine law. God gave us his commandments out of love as guideposts along the way back to him. Out of love and gratitude, I keep them, realizing that God does know best. That realization caused St. Augustine, who had ample experience of violating almost all the commandments, to say, God is intimior intimo meo. God is closer to me than I am to myself. What does a Christian have to do? What may a Christian do? Someone asked Augustine those very questions, and he gave a response that was intended for the spiritually mature, an answer that can be easily misunderstood and misinterpreted, but one which is completely correct. Augustine's reply, reminiscent of Christ's own response to the lawyer today, was disarmingly simple and direct. Ama et fata potest. Love and do whatever you want. Finally, we learned in the Acts of the Apostles that the church throughout all of Judea and Galilee and Samaria had peace and was being built up, walking in the fear of the Lord and in the comfort of the Holy Spirit, it was multiplied. How did that happen? Those early Christians obviously remembered our Lord's prayer to his Heavenly Father the night before he died. Not my will, but thine be done. They must have also mentioned when they prayed the Lord's prayer each day, thy will be done. The great Italian poet Dante, whose seventh centennial event we've been celebrating this year, knew this very well. And that's why he declared, in his will is our peace. Peace in the world, peace in our own hearts and homes, doesn't come about because of UN resolutions or political party platforms and slogans, but because of a readiness to do God's will and being possessed of a healthy fear of the Lord. That fear is not that of a slave cowering before the whip of a cruel master. No, it's the fear of a child who knows he's loved by a most loving father and will never want to do anything to disappoint him. God loves us so much that he takes us seriously. Therefore, our actions have consequences of an eternal nature, eternal happiness or eternal punishment. And let's not be afraid to underscore the point about eternal punishment for a culture that has too often stopped believing in heaven. If a man does not abide in me, he is cast forth as a branch and withers, and the branches are gathered, thrown into the fire, and burned. Those are Christ's words, not mine. And the Lord calls that up, however, with a great promise. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be full. A true Christian is not merely concerned with his own salvation. He wants to bring as many others as possible with him to heaven. That's the ultimate love of neighbor, huh? We do that by practicing the corporal and spiritual works of mercy. I think it's fair to say most of us have been pretty good at the corporal works. I suspect there's much room for improvement in the spiritual works of mercy. can help resolve their doubts. Failure to take opportunities to share the light of faith is a grave sin of omission. One of the better liturgical changes was the insertion into the Confiteor of one phrase. To the list of sins of what word and deed is added the sins of omission, what I have failed to do. Admonishing sin. Admittedly, this isn't easy. In fact, most of the biblical prophets avoided taking on the prophetic mantle, precisely because of the negative repercussions from sinners who don't want to be told we're on the wrong path. True love, however, takes the risk because the stakes are so high, if they are eternal. What's more, St. Leo warns us, quoting from Psalm 119, that great long hymn to divine law. He says, "Much peace have they that love the law." And he goes on, "This peace, even the closest ties of friendship and the most exact likeness of mind, do not really gain if they do not agree with God's will." And so back to Dante's insight. In his